They say it's lonely at the top, and that's never more true than when you're the business owner, the founder, the CEO. Sometimes we don't know who to turn to, who to talk to, and really who has our back. Well, on this show, I'm joined by my guest, Anna Vitale, the head of client services for Growth Inc., and we're going to discuss who has your back and what can a founder do to end their executive isolation. Anna, welcome to the show. So Anna, just to kick things off here about this topic of executive isolation, why it's lonely at the top, and how really no one has the founder's back, to use your words. Why is that? What is it that you hear on a daily basis with business owners when you just hear things throughout the day, throughout the weeks and months, when you're like, you know what, it feels a bit lonely?
Yeah, well, I think our owners, they're doers, right? And the reality is they do a lot. So small employer firms in America employ 1 out of 2 people who are working, contribute $2 out of $5 generated by, in our GDP. They are often the financial backbone for their families, not just immediate families, but in many cases, extended families. And they're just the person that you trust when you need something, that they can help, that they can get it done. So that position inherently can over time become lonely, because the people that you identify with as peers, or the people that you're able to reach out to help you, it just, the air gets thinner and thinner to a certain extent as you take on more responsibility at, in terms of employees that you're hiring at your firm, in terms of people that you're helping, boards you're sitting on, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It can feel very lonely. And the dynamic that you are relating on interpersonally is often that dynamic of somebody wanting something from you, whether it's an employee who wants a raise, whether it's a government agency that wants you to follow a new protocol, whether it's, another company that's suing you. All of these things are kind of energy outlays for founders. And the question is, well, who's really approaching them? Who's working with them from a perspective, not only as a peer necessarily, not just as a peer, but as someone who really gets the whole picture and understands their world and is able to step into their world just from a place of a guide, or, I'm going to walk alongside you on this and see it from your perspective. And we find that that's often a gap that many of our founder clients face.
So is it safe to say that some founders choose isolation as a protection mechanism?
I think that is safe to say. I mean, there can be some kind of control psychology happening, right? Where maybe you don't trust other people to do things as well as you do them. Maybe the reality is the people in your universe wouldn't do things as well as you. That's always a possibility. But that ability to trust, I think that experiences often teach our founders that if they don't have their eye on the ball, if they are not controlling movements and what's happening, that people are not going to catch things. They're not going to fix them in the same way that a founder is going to. That sense of ownership, literally and figuratively, is something that is difficult, difficult to replicate. And I think that is a reality. It's not just a perception on the part of the founders.
Yeah, I've noticed founders have a hard time knowing who to trust, who to listen to on the team, because they, just by the nature of being the founder, the owner, the leader, and the one who pays the checks, people tell them yes, right? They don't want to say no. So you get a lot of yes men, yes women around them. And sometimes you're like, hey, why am I not getting the whole truth? Who should I really listen to? And then that just kind of bleeds into, maybe I've seen paranoia with owners, where they're like, someone's trying to politically climb or social climb. They're not telling me things, they're holding things from me. And again, I feel like that further causes more of that isolation and feeling like no one has your back.
Totally, totally. Because everybody has an agenda. And that's true for everyone, whether you're a business owner or not, that, people, but it's rare to work with people, whether it's your partners, whether it's your employees, whether it's third parties that you hire to help you, to have, I don't know if it's realistic to think no one's ever going to have an agenda, but, you know, to find people who are able to contextualize what they want for the good of the company, for the good of whoever they're relating to, that's a certain level of self-awareness and maturity that can be very, very difficult to find.
I've noticed in many cases, the people that we confide in are our family members, our spouse. And that's not necessarily fair to them, because what do they know about all the nuances? And do they constantly want to hear us just complaining and griping about, you know, all the challenges of the day? But they are the closest to us, so they're going to shoot us straight in many cases. But that shouldn't be the only source that an individual is getting their information from, correct?
Right. No, and you're totally right. And spouses can be a great source of support. And oftentimes that, you know, I wish that I could, you know, I always had the opportunity to interview a spouse when we're working with a new client, because you probably get, you know, a lot of information very quickly that would be super helpful to understanding the situation, the context. But yeah, you want to also have fun with your spouse and not just be constantly solving problems and addressing things. And so the other sources, you know, I think our founders find could be long-term employees, people who have been with them from the beginning. That's why we see in smaller employer firms a ton of loyalty. I was talking with one of our project teams earlier today about a client that has been in business for about 20 years, and people have been promoted from within into roles that they're not necessarily qualified for, but that like you wouldn't look at their resume and hire them over someone else, barring that loyalty. But that does go a long way with founders, because you often feel like it's kind of your company against the world in some respects, and you value trust higher even than skills, for example. And not that that's wrong, but it can, in the case of this client, it can become at a certain tipping point, a hindrance to scaling, a hindrance to growth, because you don't actually have talent, you don't have your human capital aligned well with the jobs that need to be done to achieve that growth. So that's oftentimes a trade-off that we have to work closely with our founders on is, you know, yes, we know that you trust, you know, Lisa, and she's been with you in finance for forever, but fundamentally, Lisa's a bookkeeper. That's what she's trained to do. She can't be your CFO. And you actually need a CFO right now, because you need to get strategic with what's happening with your debt payments, and if the ratios are off, and if you're properly managing your AR AP cycles, and you know, what does the capital stack look like in a couple of years? All of those sorts of questions. So your question was, who do founders go to? Oftentimes it's loyal employees, which has its pros and cons. A lot of our founders are in peer groups, EO, YPO, Vistage, super, super helpful for many of our founders to be able to be in a room dialoguing in a confidential setting with other founders that they respect, that they feel carry the same weight that they're carrying and are going through the same process of creation with a company. So those groups are extremely helpful. And then firms like ours that specialize in founder, owner, executive advisory, we've seen a lot of company situations and are familiar with a lot of dynamics within those companies, both the business challenges as well as the interpersonal challenges that come with running a company.
Yeah, because it's kind of like when you peel the onion back far enough, you always kind of end up back to the founder and, you know, their own psyche, their habits. You know, they create somewhat of a microcosm, a safe space for them to operate in and exist in, like you were saying earlier, lawsuits and political threats and all these different things coming after you. So sometimes it's just safer to be in an ivory tower than to be amongst the troops. But it does negatively affect decision making in some cases, because, you know, you got to know where you're getting your information from. I heard don't get diamond advice from a goat herder kind of thing, right? It's like you got to know who's giving you the inputs. And even though your spouse or your best friends or colleagues may have your best interests in mind, they may not know the many nuances of the industry. So let's turn a corner here a little bit and talk just about mental health, the mental health of founders, and just, you know, we talk a lot about the physical health of them, just, you know, making sure the ticker's, you know, going and they're doing what they need to do to show up every single day and have the energy to be a founder. But what about just the good old fashioned mental health, and how does isolation affect that negatively?
Gosh, that's a really big question. So I think for our clients, physical health is extremely connected to mental health. So many of them have their physical health routines and journeys that they do just to keep themselves feeling good so they can have the energy and endurance for the business challenges that are going to come up. Taking breaks, I mean, one thing that can be really hard, I think, for owners, not even just founders, but any executive, it can be really hard to actually take a vacation. It's a common challenge because the feeling is, and I'm guilty of this myself. When we go on vacation, I mean, I always, after a few days, like, I want to check in because
right.
I feel like it's going to be easier for me to work a few hours and triage things and keep the trains moving than coming back to like an actual crash. And it always feels like a justified trade-off, but it's like, you need the break. Your brain actually needs the break. It's a muscle and you need to rest it. So, you know, I think that that's a big one. But it is, I would say it's a constant struggle. I mean, if you're working with a coach or a therapist, you can always get into what are my underlying reasons for behaving in this way? Like if you have trust issues with your employees, why is that? If you're, you know, if you've made more than enough money to be comfortable, why are you founding another business and still not spending the time with your family that you claim is the most important thing to you? Like what's in that? Because something usually is there, right? That if you can address it, if you can pull it out of your blind spot, you can approach life just with a lighter kind of stance, and life and work, right? So I think for every entrepreneur, the mix is different. For every owner, it's different. But if there are certain things that you know are good for your mental health, like physical activity, vacation, you know, even a personal day just to do something truly fun, if you're having difficulty accessing that, it's something that we, you know, you need to explore. Like you need to figure that out and make it a priority.
Yeah. And, you know, none of this is new. These aren't new topics. This isn't groundbreaking or earth shattering. It's like, take care of yourself. Get away from the isolation, get away from the desk, go clear your head, get around good people that are smart people, people that have your back. Is this just maybe an excuse for poor leadership? And some people just aren't great leaders. Some people just don't do what it takes. Even if they have the information, they just, it's kind of like, you know, you're supposed to do certain things. You know, you're supposed to eat your broccoli and then you don't. And then your company suffers, you suffer, and then you complain about it.
Yeah. You know, we are who we are. Like we can, there's, you know, there's limits. There's something I was reading the other day that was like self-knowledge. Like you pull back one layer of self-knowledge and you don't arrive anywhere but the next door. And
right.
So like, it's a continual journey of self-discovery in life, and you're never going to perfectly optimize any of this stuff. But I think there is a reality that, you know, we're each sort of built very well for certain areas. And founders are really built to create something new out of nothing. And not many people in the world are built to do that. And it's a really special gift. I think a lot of founders get to a place where they realize, I'm good at creating something out of nothing. I'm not necessarily good at this next phase of growing a company, of engaging a larger team. A lot of founders don't want to be managers of large teams at all. That's why you often see, like in creative companies, a founder, once the company gets to a certain point, becomes like the chief creative officer, right? Or some other specialized role that's more inherent to who they are. And that's really important to keep in mind, because, you know, we talk about creating this little this little gap or space between yourself and the business, and thinking about the business not as an extension of yourself, but as its own thing that is in creation that you've made. But what's best for the business from the perspective of the business versus what's best for the business from the perspective of myself, and finding that delineation and finding your place as an owner in that is something that we work a lot with our clients on, because as companies grow to different stages, there are people who are career CEOs of 50 to 100 million revenue companies, and they're really good at that. But they've never created something out of nothing, right? And then there are people who are really built to be executives of larger teams. But if you try to put them in a smaller team where everybody's kind of laterally reporting and there's a very mushy reporting hierarchy, they're going to really struggle with that. It's going to be frustrating that there's not a, you know, fully built out HR department to help them with this and that. So kind of knowing who you are, knowing who you're working with, and having the self-awareness, if you're in a position in your company as the owner where you're actually miserable, I mean, that's a sign, right? Or if the company is not growing, that's a sign that something here is dysfunctional. Either I'm not happy because this isn't where I'm meant to be, or the company isn't thriving because someone isn't where they're meant to be.
Right. So if you're speaking with a business owner who's feeling like no one has their back, and they're feeling a bit isolated and they don't know what's next or where to turn, they know they need help. Maybe their business is doing well, but them personally are not doing so great. What would be your advice to that individual?
Gosh, probably that join one of the peer groups would be my first thought, because that is where you're going to find your people. You're going to find the other people who are at the top. I think that that's, and it doesn't have to necessarily be official, though I think that without that accountability to a group, it's not something that owners are likely to prioritize independently, because it's never going to be the most important thing that's happening that day. But over the long term, it's one of the most important things. So find a group of peers that you make a commitment to. You know, of course, always you can call us. We love to talk about this stuff. And, you know, just the isolation, there is some truth to it, like we talked about at the beginning. But some of it is perception, and some of it could be a condition that you're creating that you don't even realize that you are creating it. You know, our happiest owners, they totally trust the people that they're working with, their C-suite, the people that they're hiring. They're able to move through more of this stuff just in a smoother way, because they've built a team that supports them, and they've hired people who they trust, whether they're people who have been with the company a long time or a shorter amount of time. But they kind of have that faith based on experience in their people, in the team that they've built around them. And so, but some of it is unavoidable. Some of it is just heavy as the head that wears the crown. And, you know, I think this, a lot of our clients probably fantasize about having a job, having a paycheck, having, you know, and it's like, the reality is they're just not built for that. Like, it's awesome as it sounds, it's just not who they're going to be. And so, yeah, it's sort of like this grappling of like, this is, you know, I'm actually meant to be an owner. This is who I am.
Yeah, that's a great insight. As we close this thing out, what would be one word of encouragement for entrepreneurs and business owners?
You've got this, and thank you. I mean, I have a lot of respect and a lot of appreciation for entrepreneurs, for founders who are doing this, because it takes a ton, not just of work. It's not just work. It's the emotions that come with the roller coaster of running a company. And so, yeah, I would just say thank you.
Awesome. Thanks, Anna. This is a great show.
Thanks, Tim. All right. Talk to you soon.